Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this event in the European Parliament with the title Trolls of the 21st Century, Kremlin Inside Western Media. And we have a range of both guests who have come from abroad, from outside Belgium, but also members of the European Parliament who have invited to this event. Two of them are the first two speakers today. But before I hand over the words to them, just one practical remark. I want to remind you that we are today working with a simultaneous interpretation between English and Russian. And because of that, and because of the fact that the meeting today is being live streamed, we should be sure, make sure to speak slowly so that the interpreters can translate every little piece of brilliant point that we make, and so that what we say can be heard and understood also in the live streaming. Welcome again. My name is Jon Kust. I'm a diplomat working for European External Action Service in the East Stratcom Task Force, and I'm going to moderate the meeting today. But I hand over the word to Petras Auštrevičius. Petras.
Thank you. Good morning to everybody. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, this is my privilege and honor, in fact, to say a couple of introductory words. And this event is a joint project of my colleague Rebecca Harms from Greens, Michael Bonny, EPP, and Mark Demesmaeker, European Conservatives and Reformist, and I myself representing ALDE Group in the European Parliament. We thought that it's time to get a look into something deeper, looking at trolling and media penetration issues from the European Parliament point of view. I should remind you that original meaning of troll is a supernatural being in Norse mythology. This is a Scandinavian folklore part. And in original, troll may have been a negative synonym. And I believe it became a very negative synonym even in 21st century, where trolling have been given absolutely different meaning, as especially what comes to media and information. And indeed, today we will discuss trolling of Western media. That's why we should remind ourselves how it works, how much it's penetrated, and to what extent it's influenced by third countries, not to name Russia. And in fact, trolling supported by Russian state become a very important part of countries' foreign and domestic policies, with overreaching state control. I would mention probably a couple of features of Russian trolling. It's a policy-driven, it's very systematic, it's mass production, and it's offensive. So that's why to look at this phenomena and to get a grip on it, not the politicians should talk. Only experts know how it's done, and those who have a personal experience. So that's why it's my indeed honor to introduce those journalists who are today. You will hear them. You will have a possibility to ask them directly questions. So that's why I'm very happy we made this event today, and I believe this is not the last event of this kind. We have to continue because trolling is not for 1 year. It's a phenomenal issue, which is a part of Kremlin policy. So to understand Russia, we have to understand trolling first of all. Thank you very much for coming, and I'm looking forward for a great event today. Thank you.
Thank you, Petras. Important point also noting that the presence of 4 different political groups in the Parliament shows a broad interest in the topic. Next speaker is also a member of the European Parliament, Michael Bonny.
Good morning, everybody. I fully agree with all of those things which were presented by Petras, and I think that we need this kind of debate, and that we need to continue our work and our better and deeper understanding of the problem. In Europe, we are living under the rule of law and with full respect of the freedom of expression. They are key values. It is important to understand it, especially in the digital era, when we have many new possibilities for sharing the information by the various types of channels and social media, and there is the freedom of expression guaranteed. Of course, the tradition of the freedom of expression is related to the responsibility. When I'm speaking, I'm responsible for my words. But in the internet era, very often people are hidden behind anonymized names. Then it is easier to create hate speech, to manipulate the information, to establish the completely untrue picture of the world and the problems, using all possible linguistic and infographic tools, also using trolls and factories of trolls. We are also living under the war conditions, especially in the eastern neighborhood, because of Russian aggression. But the war circumstances are broader than the territories of eastern Ukraine. It is because of the media networks, traditional TV channels and radio programs, and the new in digital devices. So this is the real war, although very often in the virtual space. This is the example of the hybrid war. How we need to respond? This is the key topic of today's discussion. We invited many people who understand the problem, who are active at the area of fighting against propaganda and various types of internet attacks and trolling. To conclude, let me say this. During the martial law in Poland, during the 80s, I was involved in the Solidarity movement, also as chief editor of the underground newspaper Vola. Every week we have been preparing the edition of this newspaper with information from factories, information of conspiracy activities in the factories, at the universities, with commentaries about communist policy in Poland. It was the world of independent data, information, and vision of the politics. It was one of the most important factors to keep our independence and solidarity. Can you believe that we were able to squeeze 14 usual sized pages to one sheet of paper? All of those things were possible because of the power of the network, solidarity network with people active in the factories, with journalists, with people organizing and making the print and the distribution, conspiracy chain, freedom chain. With this little story, I would like to wish us fruitful discussion today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bonny, for your intervention. Important points about technology, the technological aspect of the challenges we're seeing. Also, thank you for taking us back to a time where the technological situation was a little bit different, but where there might be also some overlaps in the challenges faced. Thank you for that. You also stressed both the members of the European Parliament, who now open stressed the importance of the presence in the room of experts. We very much appreciate the opportunity we have today to speak to, listen to people who are experts in the field. I guess without experts, the policy making process becomes difficult. So we welcome the first speaker today. The first speaker is Alexandra Karmazapova. She is from Nova Gazeta, a newspaper many might know in Russia, one of the independent Russian media. She also contributes to other media, such as Gazeta.ru, which is also known to those who read in Russian, but also New York Times and the famous Moscow radio station Echo Moskvy. Alexandra, claim to fame in this context is the fact that she was one of the first people to identify, through her investigative journalism, the existence of the so-called troll factories in St. Petersburg, which is now a fact known to the general public in the world and in Russia, thanks to Alexandra and her colleagues. So, Alexandra, I hand over the word to you.
Well, I hope that everyone had headsets. With your permission, I will speak Russian today. I don't want to be judgmental. I just want to outline for you how a troll factory works. And it's located not far from St. Petersburg. There are several hundred Russian students who work 24/7, and they praise Vladimir Putin. They write endlessly how they love him and how bad the US and other Western countries are. That's what you see on the screen. It's a first troll office. It's located in Olgina, in the suburbs of St. Petersburg. And that's exactly where the term troll factory stemmed from. Then they moved to Savushkina, another village in the vicinity of St. Petersburg. Actually, one of the activists, a representative of the opposition, was looking for a job. So she saw an ad saying that she could start working as a person who deals with information. So she went to this office in Olgina. There, during the interview, they told her that Alexei Navalny, an opposition leader, was running for mayor's position in Moscow. So she had to write in bad terms of how awful he was. So she got the message. She realized that it was a bit strange, so she didn't want to work there, but she published a blog on the St. Petersburg branch of Echo Moskvy. However, very few people noticed it because it was only journalists who paid attention to that publication. So it wasn't clear. And as a result, we decided to launch our own journalist investigation. We wanted to get this job at least for a day or two so that to know it from inside out. So we went to this troll factory. Perhaps we could switch the slides. Next slide, please. Here you have a description of what kind of payment you get when you work at the troll factory. Also, there are a lot of ads in, next slide, please. There are a lot of ads in newspapers. And here are some pictures for you. So we went there, we wanted to get this job. And among the people who worked there, we saw two characters who were really memorable because just looking at them, we realized that this troll factory was directly connected to the Kremlin. One of them was Maria Kuprashevich, and you see her in the picture. She is a girl who joined the opposition media in Russia so that to find some materials, kind of compromising materials on opposition journalists, so that then she could jeopardize their career. She worked for Yevgeny Prigozhin, who is a crony of Vladimir Putin. He is the head of the Concord company. It's a company in Russia that tends to win all the tenders to provide supplies to the armed forces, to schools. They feed Russian school children and Russian military personnel. And they also provide cleaning services for the Russian armed forces. Yevgeny Prigozhin is also well known for being a provider of services. He did it himself, actually, for the Putin's inauguration in 2011. So this troll factory is directly linked to Yevgeny Prigozhin, who is a friend of Vladimir Putin, and thus it is directly connected to the Kremlin. It's a fact. It's really hard to argue with that. Next slide, please. So let's focus on how the trolls actually work, because I've just outlined who they're heads are. But we need to realize that when it comes to the texts you read, these are written by students. So I don't want to be blamed for making it all up. I wanted to show you a specific slide. You see a girl on the screen. She is 20 now, but 2 years ago, she was participating in different foray. She claimed that she hated the US and she praised Vladimir Putin. So her nickname was Romashka, Chamomile, or Daisy, if you will. So she wrote that life was difficult because all you can do, what can you do about the US? why people quit the US, why do they leave when they go there? Because it's really expensive. Only if you are a capitalist, then you can live well. So there are children there. They look around and they become violent. And that's exactly the answer to your question, why there is so much violence in the US. Because there is no middle class in the US, she claimed. You are either dirt poor or you are stinkingly rich, because then you've stolen all these things from other people. I really liked what she wrote regarding the situation of the Russian people who live in the US. They cannot leave the US because there are problems with their papers, so they cannot leave the country. They are trapped. So they want to leave, but they can't. I also remember what she wrote, that in Russia, people have a soul. They're so hospitable. But the West, it's so cold, because you go visit them and then they give you names behind your back. So people also go to fast food, and fast food has come to Russia. As a result, now Russian people are exposed to different ailments and illnesses. So even from abroad, they are undermining the health of the Russian people. So they have skyscrapers, but there is no air there. And Russia is so much better than the US. By the way, there was a mistake in the Russian verb. So I think it's quite telling who she is. But at the same time, she claimed that Russia's education is much better than that in the US, because you have to pay through your nose for your tuition. But in Russia, it's all free. Well, unfortunately, when she wrote all this, she also made a lot of spelling mistakes, which kind of undermines her thesis. So there is a social equivalent of Facebook in Russia. It's called ВКонтакте. Next slide, please. Thank you. Here you see our correspondence with this girl, whose nick was Ramashka, which is Daisy 2908. So ask her, doesn't she feel ashamed to write commentaries and being paid for them? And she said, so what? What's your problem? Well, that was crystal clear to me, and I had no further questions for her. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Here you see another character from this troll factory. His name is Alexei Soskovets. He is an entrepreneur from St. Petersburg. He was the one who hired us to work at the troll factory. Well, it is clear that the leadership of the troll factories is directly linked to the Kremlin, because Yevgeny Prigozhin is a friend of Vladimir Putin, and it's also connected or linked to the powers in St. Petersburg. Alexei Soskovets is a young entrepreneur from St. Petersburg. He has a service providing company. In 2013, they won 17 tenders in the city to conduct several events. Half of the tenders was conducted in such a way that there were no competitors, so they were the only ones who submitted the bid, and as a result, they won. By the way, in 2013, this company also won the tender to provide transportation for activists from the pro-Kremlin movement Nashi to Seliger. This became well known because the contract for these transportation services were multiplied by the factor of six. In other words, it cost the state six times what they could have paid had it been honest and had there been another service provider. Next slide, please. Actually, we conducted this investigation for quite a while. We analyzed the situation very thoroughly. And despite the fact that we are Russian citizens, sometimes we are a bit naive, because we believed that once we publish materials on the troll factory, it would just disappear from the face of the earth. Unfortunately, that was not the case. The troll factory is still there. It continues its dirty work. And later on, when our publications and those of our colleagues were published, Lyudmila Savchuk, for instance, it's a Russian activist who worked there for 2 months, and she started a case against them because she wanted to get all the materials from the troll factory. She went to court against them. And then there were new publications where myself, Alexander Savchuk, Evgenia Savchuk, and my colleague Alexander Soshnikov were blamed for being pro-Western, to be agents of influence of the West. So they also cited our correspondence via the media. They claim that we are representatives of the opposition and we want to help the West to conquer Russia, because otherwise, had we been the real patriots, we should be actually helping the trolls. And in conclusion, let me tell you that had it been just the trolls, okay, we could have even identified with them given the context in modern Russia. But the problem actually is this. At the factory you have other people, not just the trolls. There are other representatives of the media, and so-called Ukrainian media are present there. And those people publish fake information, and my colleague Mr. Fetchenko will tell you more about that, because they feed the news. There is a site, News from Kharkiv. These people, however, are located in St. Petersburg, but they pretend that they are in Ukraine. Okay, that could work as well, but a colleague of mine, now it's my colleague, but for 2 months he had also worked at the troll factory. And during his work there, he worked as a journalist there. And I could even give you his name. His name is Vitaly Bespalov. It's not a secret. So he told us that he was on the first floor there in this building, and he made news for the trolls who were on the second floor. So the troll on the second floor presents himself as a US national. Everything is bad in the US. He really would like to leave the US and go to Russia. On the first floor, journalists produce news where they say, well, there is an exile movement from the US. The Americans want to flee the country. They want to go to Russia. Well, everybody understands that there are no Americans like that, but no one wants to check it. And so the media under Mr. Prigozhin provides this information to the market, to the journalist market. So it's not just about the bloggers who get paid for that, who write nonsense about the US, Europe, or Ukraine. No. Here we have a situation when these people are officially licensed as journalists and they provide disinformation, misinforming society. However, they cannot be held responsible because they are directly linked to the Kremlin. They have green light from the Kremlin and they can continue and be scot-free. And the situation won't change. And let me also add here that there is another problem in this context. There is a certain circle of liberals in Russia who know very well about the trolls. They read the comments in the forums. They understand that these people are not for real. They are trolls. However, there is the majority of the Russian population who has never heard about the trolls. So they take it at its face value. They read the comments and they believe them. And then they think that, okay, maybe that's exactly how it is. Perhaps there is a grain of truth in it, because it's one thing when you discuss the situation with liberally minded journalists, and it's a totally different picture when you talk to ordinary individuals, and then you understand after 5 minutes that these people actually believe what they read there. And then when they start reading other news, they start commenting the posts from foreign news, and I would very much like to believe that those people who are located abroad, who read Russian news from abroad, they see through all these fake posts. They understand that this has been written by trolls, because a real Russian would never spend all his time online praising Vladimir Putin, because you have to be schizophrenic to be like this. And that's what I would like to say at the end of my presentation. Thank you.
Спасибо вам, Александр, за...
Thank you, Alexander, for this very interesting and important information, because you've given us a lot of information. And you gave us a brief outline of how the troll factory works, what technologies they use. And I noted for myself a couple of things here. First of all, you said that you were hoping that once you reveal what this straw factory is all about, this thing will disappear from the face of the earth. Well, it immediately reminded me of some fairy tales, because if you give the real name to the troll disappears. That's the way it should be in fairy tales, but in reality, unfortunately, the situation is different. And it doesn't match exactly what we remember from fairy tales and its world. Well, another thing that I noted for myself, that although many people in Russia and abroad know that the troll factory is in the vicinity of St. Petersburg, there is still this majority that believes what they read. So they think that this is actually the voice of the Russian people. I think this is an interesting theme that will be addressed at our later discussion today.
Over the word to the next speaker, Yevhen Fedchenko from Kiev. Yevhen is a representative of the already, I think I can easily say, quite well known, at least among those who deal with these issues, site called Stop Fake, which addresses one of the issues that was covered in Alexandra's talk, namely the issue of disinformation. You work with disinformation from a Ukrainian perspective, since, as we know, Ukraine has been not only, as one of the, as Mikhail said in his speech, that Ukraine has become a battleground in a very direct sense of the war that is still going on in Ukraine, but also in the sort of abstract sense of a battleground of ideas, and certainly a battleground where disinformation is being used. You are working for Stop Fake, but you're also a director of the Mohyla School of Journalism at the National University in Kiev, and you contribute also to a media that many of us know quite well, such as Radio Free Europe, BBC, Radio Canada International, and many, many others. Welcome, Yevheny, and thank you for coming all the way from Kiev.
Thank you so much. Good morning. Just continuing what Alexandra said, according to trolls, me and members of Stop Fake team are always, sometimes, or always portrayed as CIA agents paid by Mossad and associated with ISIS. If you can imagine that, but in reality, our team is doing just the opposite. We really try to bring disinformation back to journalistic roots, to verify information. And unfortunately, we have a lot of work to do because the intensity of Kremlin propaganda is not only not decreasing, but just the opposite. It's increasing because previously it was mostly concentrated on Ukraine. If we can go to the first slide. Ukraine was the first and immediate object of Kremlin propaganda, but in reality, the real target is the global audience because Ukraine just became the testing ground for old new technologies which are used by Kremlin for disinformation, and unfortunately, fakes are only small fraction of the instruments and platforms that are used within this huge disinformation campaign, as well as trolls are. And it's really important to understand that Russian propaganda is aiming at the global audience, and we can basically substitute in what they are manufacturing the word Ukraine with any other word, and can perfectly well for any other country. And there is also not only kind of a media-related related ramification of this, because fakes are killing journalism. It's corrupt journalism, and finally it's killing journalism because it's do one very simple thing. It makes people disbelieving in what they're reading, watching, consuming from internet. So if we would compare contemporary Russian propaganda to, let's say, Soviet propaganda, the big difference is that Soviet propaganda was promoting its own values, whatever the values that values might be. But the contemporary propaganda is all about confusion, about giving as much nonsense, absurd, non-information as possible to make sure that people would not be trusting anyone, would not be trusting institutions, would not be trusting other country that it was mentioned in Alexandra presentation. And propaganda so far was really very successful in creating the hatred, first towards Ukrainians, then towards West in general. And again, just to repeat that Ukraine is just the immediate battleground where everything is happening. But in reality, the aim is global audience. And the second ramification is a military ramification, because propaganda is a part of information warfare, larger information warfare. And within, again, contemporary theory of Russian warfare, information component is even much more important than the hardware military component per se. So if we can map the trends in information warfare, we can easily predict where the polite green man can pop up at the next destination. Now we can go to the next slide. So propaganda is really aiming globally and operates globally. It implies very different instruments, starting with now household names like RT and Sputnik in 40 languages operating in many, many countries. And they are working for international audience, that there would be a huge silo of tools that would work for Russian domestic audience. And of course, they would be different in terms of the strategies they employ and instruments. And then at the very bottom, there would be a huge horizontal network of trolls who are contributing again to disrupt the communication by providing as much of nonsense as possible. And we can go to the next slide now. Just to remind where we've been 1 year and a half ago, the famous story that every Ukrainian military battling in Donbas would be rewarded to slaves from the local population and slot of the land as a reward for their participation in military campaign. And many Ukrainian military are still waiting for two slaves to come. It did not happen. Very famous story of a crucified boy, which became the classical example. And the point here is that it was broadcast on the most mainstream, the most primetime program. And it was saying that Ukrainian army is crucifying little kids. And when journalists from Channel 1's been confronted and asked to explain why they put this obviously fake story, which how they can explain is that they said that it's not me who should explain that it's how it can be true, it's all of you who should explain that it's not true. So that's basically brings the whole concept of journalism from the foot up to the head, because it was always the job of journalists to find facts, to support whatever they want to say, not the opposite, that the audience or Stop Fake or anyone else should be following and catching journalists or so-called journalists producing fakes like this. Again, that can be, if we would look separately at the stories like this, they might really look very funny. And if you would follow Stop Fake, you can have a daily portion of a good laugh. But that's only when you are looking at it at the as a separate units, separate entities. When you start to consume it in mass, it really creates very bizarre reality around you. And if you would be immersed into that reality for quite a long time, and here I can relate you to the famous story in the New York Times, where the journalist was locked him up at the hotel room and watching Russian television for 7 days, and he was just lost. I mean, he was media literate. He was a journalist with very high level of critical perception of the media, and he was completely lost. He was driven mad. And he decided to stop. And here I can quote Andropov, who basically invented all this many, many years ago, who said that propaganda is like when you are sniffing a stuff, when you do that once or twice, you're still okay. But if you start doing that permanently, you are absolutely a different person. And I would trust Andropov, because again, all the instruments we are analyzing now, they've been created many, many years ago, but they've been put into the new context and they're using new instruments, for example, like internet, because trolls were not there maximum what they can do at Andropov's time, they could send letters to newspapers, but that's not the fact that everybody would be publishing them or reading them. We can go to the next. So the basic aim of these fakes, for example, towards Ukraine, were to bring chaos, to destabilize Ukraine from within, to demoralize Ukrainian troops, to demoralize Ukrainian people, and to prove to the West that Ukraine basically is a failed state. We can go to the next. For example, also discredit Ukraine the international sphere. For example, this fake about Ukraine, which turns down debt restructuring proposal, was even picked up by quite mainstream media like Deutsche Welle. And the problem here is, was, yes, when Yatsenyuk was asked if Ukraine is going to pay, he said no, but it was 1 week before the Russia did make this offer. So if we could put that into the right temporal context, that would really bring quite another meaning to this. And this is just one of the instruments how you can do fake. You just take a little bit of truth, put it into the larger untruthful context. You can manipulate the headline. You can invent non-existing sources which you are quoting. These so-called media are very often quoting Western media. We can go now to the next slide. For example, German media, they are quoting a Contra magazine, which probably not many of you would encounter, even if you read in Deutsch, because they always trying to pick up quite marginal or non-existent media. And then basically you can attribute anything. So formally they are following the rules of the journalism because you need to name sources and you need to have at least two of them. So very often RIA is quoting TASS and Sputnik as two sources of their information, and Sputnik would be quoting TASS and RIA. So they are kind of, it's the same like with trolls on the second and third floor. They are just quoting each other, and very often it's very difficult to find out who originated the story. We can go to the next slide. And we can go to the next slide just to... for example, situation with Crimea was very widely used by trolls and by, again, so-called media to produce as many fake as possible to increase the tensions and to make sure that Ukrainians and Tatars would be struggling each other, and then to make sure that, again, Ukraine would be internationally discredited. And they also were trying to persuade Ukrainians that if there would be outage of electricity for Crimea, half of Ukraine would also be left in the dark, to make sure that Ukrainian would be pressing on their own government. But what is interesting here is the picture on the right. This is a mobile TV set. So that's quite a new invention, and they were widely used, at least what I noticed first, they were widely used in Crimea to make sure that even when people are left without electricity and very basic scenes, they are still connected by the cord, invisible cord, to the pipeline of this disinformation, which is television. Because if we would go again to statistics, 94% of Russians consume their news from television. For Ukraine, it would be 85%, and this is quite a common for post-Soviet and post, I would call it post-socialist countries. Again, I already mentioned that you can substitute the word Ukraine with the name of any other country, and the instruments would be basically the same. For example, the weather forecast. So that on the right was produced for Donetsk, for Debaltseve. So the weatherman explains that this is a perfect weather to start ground operation and to bomb someone over there, because the weather is very favorable to that. And the picture on the left would be used approximately 6 months later for Syria, explaining that the weather is perfect, sky is transparent, clear, it's great weather, so please go ahead and bomb it. And of course it all works for the domestic audience, explaining that everything would be great and we are kind of moving forward and building up kind of a informational momentum for military operation. We can go next. Ukraine is, I would say it so, Ukraine already might slip below the radar of the Russian disinformation because of the other problems coming up, like Syria and then Turkey, but it would be unfair. So Russian propaganda decided to combine it all together because you can use both Ukraine and Syria, and for example, saying that Ukraine is supplying forces to struggle in Syria on different sides. Ukraine is supplying arms to both sides, at least. And of course, and they even introduced the new word. So previously it was banderite fascists, and now they are calling it banderite Islamists. So if you can follow, so it's like kind of Ukrainian nationalists slash Islamists, and then you can slash and basically add anything you wish. And now we can go to the next slide. But the bottom line of all this, if you would analyze this, it's all constructed on anti-Western platform. And by the way, Russian propaganda does not differentiate good West and bad West. So for those who do propaganda, there is no any difference between the United States or Western Europe. It all goes like we versus them, good versus evil. So it's absolutely a Manichaean approach to portraying the world. Not only media participate in that. I just took three tweets from Russian ambassador to London, Yakovenko, and you can follow him. It would also give you a great pleasure of everyday reading because, for example, the first picture is basically from the movie. I don't know if he knew that or not, but this is an actor who is playing Islamist, and that's how Russia is persuading anyone that you really need us in coalition, and because of this dangerous but actually funny Islamist portrayed over there. And at the same time, they are using caricatures from a Cold War period, like this portraying NATO as a huge monster dominating over the landscape. And then they say again, but let's be friends, because you need us. We don't know why for this coalition, but you need us. And they're using the photos from World War II propaganda, which saying this man is friend because we fight for your liberty. And so we see how basically the narrative from propaganda goes to diplomacy or Russian diplomacy, and then talking points from Russian diplomacy coming back to what trolls are producing or propaganda machine of mainstream media, and you see this bizarre world of how it's all interconnected. We can go now next. But now actually there is a big new enemy, and this is Turkey. And of course, now they're looking ways for connect Turkey to Ukraine and then connect both to ISIS again. So, but again, if you would start reading this, it would provide you a lot of good laugh, but again, a lot of kind of in-depth understanding how absurd this world is. And just to portray you the atmosphere in of this anti-Turkinism, there was a famous a quotation from one of Russian healthcare officials who said that every time you buy Turkish tomatoes, you contribute to shutdowning of Russian planes. And as a result, now it's kind of a mainstream, a commonplace on Russian mainstream television when people are saying, okay, let's nuke Istanbul, just very small bomb, probably just to start at the beginning, you know. So this really brings us to a big difference with the Cold War time, because at that point, the use of nuclear weapons was a huge taboo, and the containment was, and nuclear weapons was used for containment, not for offensive scenes. And now it really became the commonplace, and this is bring us basically to the place where we understand how dangerous propaganda can be, because previously it instigated just the conventional warfare on the territory of other countries, but now it basically brings the audience to the next level. Let's just use nukes, so ordinary, so normal. And probably I need to stop already. And just to kind of make a conclusion that first, just to give you the idea how quickly the audience can be adopted to what propaganda, what to eat. So, for example, it took 1 to 2 months to persuade general Russian audience that Ukraine is their enemy number one. And then if we look at Turkey, it took basically a couple of days, from a couple to a week, to create the image of Turkey as the biggest enemy. So which means that the audience is already so prepared to believe anything propaganda is kind of feeding to them that it really brings us to very kind of dangerously low level of perception and critical perception of information. Probably I would stop here, and then if you would have any questions, we can come back to this. Thank you.
Thank you, Yevhen, for a very interesting and very substantial intervention. I think what we heard from you was a very very, so to speak, organic follow-up on Alexandra's talk. We moved from the trolls into two other aspects of what is often labeled propaganda, namely fake disinformation on the one hand, but also what you could call narratives and the translatability of narratives. When you say that there is in propaganda sort of an overarching story that you tell, the story of a country finding itself under attack, and that you can translate this image of the enemy from one place to the other, which also, of course, underlines the importance of the Ukrainian experience. How it is understanding that process is one is important for instrumental for understanding the process that came after in the Middle East and in Turkey. And of course, also I think from the diplomatic perspective, I find it interesting to note your pointing out how mass media and trolling has contributed to the to an escalation, which allows even for the naming of nuclear arms, something that was certainly not something we did earlier on. We do have time for questions now. We started a little bit late, so I imagine that we will work with this, asking questions to Alexandra and Yevhen for until at 20 minutes past 10. So there's a question there, sir.
Thank you very much. I'm Pavlo Khazan. I'm a member of the Regional Council from Ukraine. And I have a remark and the question. In the continuing what Yevgen said, we faced this very interesting problem in Ukraine. Then on the territory which is occupied now by Russia and separatists, but not only on those territories, we have very clear, very powerful, and very good quality of broadcasting of pro-Russian radio and television. And this is not just the trolls in internet. This is the television and radio, and for many territories, especially for small villages and cities, where we have no normal Ukrainian broadcasting. In fact, this is about 90, even more, percent of the population covered by Russian or pro-Russian TV and radio channels. And we investigated this question because I participated in anti-terrorist operation before I was elected as a regional deputy. And we found that this is about from 80 to 90% of Russian and pro-Russian broadcasting, and the level and the quality of Ukrainian broadcasting, radio and TV broadcasting, is much lower than Russian. We understand, of course, that Russia has a lot of resources to make the very good amplifiers, very good equipment, but at the same time, I believe that this is the very, very big international problem, that I completely agree with you about these technologies, but this is very simply technologies. This is not short waves. The people of my age remember how we listened to Voice of America and BBC on short waves, but this is not the short waves. This is UHF and VHF ranges. This is FM radio, and this is the metro TV broadcasting. And the question is that, what do you think about how we can prevent it, how we can fight with this situation? Thank you.
Yeah, actually, what you portrayed is really a huge problem because propaganda is not stopping, as I mentioned, and the problem is that it's omnipresent. It's everywhere, and if you are less using internet, then there would be radio for you. If you are not listening to radio, there would be TV channels. And the problem here, and you partially already answered this question, is not only the physical availability of Ukrainian alternatives, but also the content. Because why Russian television is, and always was, popular everywhere where the Russian-speaking population was? Because of the quality of the content, because of the number of money they put into production of this quality of content. And that was widely used because if we would look at the different types of programming, different genre of programming, propaganda would be built in each of them. It's not only about news. It would be absolutely a mistake to think that propaganda is only about news and then all other programming is okay, because propaganda was kind of working for 10 years already, at least. And by the way, very soon they would be celebrating 10th anniversary of Russia Today, so that probably can be the mark to start counting the contemporary propaganda. So they've been constructing little by little, gradually, this idea of Russian world, Ruskiy Mir, everywhere. And this idea was implanted more obvious or more latent in all types of programming, movies, concerts, shows, talk shows, even children programming was infected by this. So, and this continued for many, many years. So it really took quite efforts to build this up. And of course, it cannot be just switched off because there is no this magic switcher. So we need to find other alternatives to create another big amount of quality programming, which would be related to what people over there want to watch. And this is a big problem and this is a big challenge for us.
Thank you very much. Petras, you have a question.
Yes, Alexandra. I want to ask you a question. I mean, to what extent an experienced and probably independent-minded journalist resist being recruited by those companies or being involved in this trawling activities or around. I mean, do you believe that the ethics of journalism is still alive in Russia? That those professionals have enough, let's say, strength to resist? I mean, being paid, invited to parties, and getting closer to power, it's sometimes inviting, but do you feel that Russian trolling factories are able to recruit best minds in Russia?
I don't know actually how to answer your question.
Мне кажется, что.
Okay. This may come across as unpatriotic in comparison to what you hear in Russia, but I believe that in Russia right now there is no politics, no policy, or no journalism. So there is a small layer of journalists who are trying to do something, but there are very few of them. And as regards their financial backing, it's also very limited. And now I can tell you that there is a big number of Russian journalists, particularly those in St. Petersburg. They have been frustrated. They feel disappointed because journalism per se has been tarnished. Because remember what I told you in my presentation. We thought that once we reveal this information on the troll factory, they will disappear from the face of the earth. But no, nothing like that happened. It's actually very humiliating to pay for being praised in the media. Well, if you really believe that you are strong and smart, then perhaps people should be referring to you in positive terms for free. Well, I believe that there is no reputation per se in Russia. There is no policy, there is no politics, and there is no journalism. Who pays attention to what the troll factory produces? Just foreigners. Because for Russia, it's a daily routine. We all know that there are several hundred students who are being paid more than an average pay so that they could continue writing, praising Vladimir Putin and blaming Europe for being a land of homosexuals and LGBTs. And who is Mr. Obama? He's just an ape. This is a quote. But for ordinary Russians, it's just a reality. We understand this is not an adequate description of reality, because it's like trying to tell someone that 2 + 2 = 4, but you hear in answer, no, it's actually 5. Why does he say that? Because he's been paid to keep saying that 2 + 2 = 5. Well, all I can tell you that journalists are trying to put up some resistance, but there are fewer and fewer of them, because that's how Putin's Russia is structured. There is no need for quality journalism. All they need is just journalists who continue praising Putin, that there is no corruption in Russia, that the prosecutor general has no links whatsoever to any mafia groups, because the results of Navalny's investigation have been published. Mr. Bastrykin claims that he has no links to Russian mafia either, despite the publication of the prosecutor general's office in Spain. To the contrary. So we have leadership that is directly connected to mafia, but those journalists who are trying to reveal this, they are being blamed for being the fifth column, supporting the West against Russia. And other journalists, they are real patriots who wish well for the motherland. So it's impossible to describe in rational terms when you appeal to Russian voters and tell them that actually the voting campaign is being rigged. You hear in answer, well, that's how it is everywhere. Your officials steal from you. Well, every official steals, no matter where they are. What? Is President Obama better than President Putin? No, he is actually worse because he is black. That's what you get in Russia, because in Russia, racism is on the rise. Don't forget about that. Thank you, Alexandra.
When you ask a question, do introduce yourself.
Hello, Vytautas Bruveris, Lithuanian daily newspaper, Lietuvos Rytas. I would like to address my question to Alexandra. First of all, congrats, thumbs up, colleague, and good job you have done, but...
I just want to congratulate you on your work.
So I can ask in Russian and then translate by myself to English, so I can be a translator. So maybe I will speak in two languages.
If you ask your question, a short question, first in English and then in Russian, and then you can answer in Russian. And while that is happening, I hope there's a technician here who can help us to making Alexandra's headset work. Thank you.
Хотел спросить ваше мнение про, ну вот.
I just wanted to hear your opinion on how you perceive the situation in the West, because there is this society, public, civil society in the West, and there is political elite. I agree with you when you say that the trolls is the main strategy that's being used by Russian propaganda and by the Kremlin, but its main target audience is in the West, because when they see that there is this time-tested propaganda that is used domestically, but you cannot work or use it in the West, then they introduce that approach in a slightly modified manner vis-a-vis the Western audience, because the trolls, their work boils down to propaganda per se. But as regards the influence on the Western society, does it actually work? Are they winning this battle for the minds of the Western audience or not?
Yeah,
I think it's okay not without interpretation now, because you without you translating, because everyone heard the English simultaneous interpretation of your question. Yes, very good.
I believe that this kind of works, but not as much as they would like it to work. I agree with what you say, because yesterday I heard one viewpoint, and it's a key viewpoint for me at least. And actually, it was an eye-opener for me on the Russian politics. Well, apparently there are two categories of people. One of them is composed of citizens, and another one is composed of consumers. Consumers never ask questions. So all they want to hear is, there is a discount, 20%, but there is 40% discount, and he runs backwards. Well, I think when it comes to the Russian society, it's composed of consumers, whereas the Western audience is mainly citizens who ask questions. So even if people claim that they love Mr. Putin, but at the same time, this citizen knows that this European person doesn't want to go to Russia because from his friends, he knows that can be robbed even by policemen and they will get scot-free doing that. Well, then the person may think, okay, I know what this person is writing. He claims that in Russia it's paradise, but I know that it's not actually the case, so I won't go there. So perhaps propaganda works as a brainwashing tool for the domestic audience, because Russia's history, it's really difficult to grasp. Because, for instance, take a woman who is in a private house, but there is no water supplies and there is no electricity. So every day, on a regular basis, for 5 hours, she doesn't have electricity, but she keeps watching telly. And on telly, what she hears is description of horrors in the US. Why is she interested in what is happening in the US, despite the fact that on a daily basis there is a blackout for 5 hours? She's freezing. And what is more, her kids, they cannot even enroll in the kindergarten, because the kindergartens at some time were given as offices for commercial companies. But she doesn't care about that. It's much more important to her to know what Mr. Obama did or what Chancellor Merkel did, whom they met, and what horrors Europe is exposed to. So for me, it's mind-boggling why this woman never asks questions about her daily life. And I believe, and I would like to hope, that European citizens keep asking questions. And also, there are a lot of things that they would like to specify. And I would very much like to hope that these people then go against what they read online from the trolls.
That you had a comment to what was just said by Alexandra.
Actually, my point of view is that it might be effective, because propaganda is using the plurality of the Western world and exploit it for its own benefits. And this is their concept of the second opinion is really very important, because it plays well with Western attitudes toward what media should be saying, how policymakers should react. And basically, they look at this as a weakness of the West, because what propaganda is working for is not a plurality, it's a singularity of the opinion. And if they go to the Western world, they really try to find the soft spots within each country, And if they see any, you know, pluralistic discussions on anything in Belgium or in any other country, they really would be exploiting it to their own benefits and to the maximum of its benefit. And the second thing is that they really want to, what I'm calling, to abduct the narrative on all the issues. And initially they abducted the narrative on Crimean occupation and then the war in the east of Ukraine, and they've been forming it primarily, and the West was responding to it. And this is, was a kind of a big mistake. And one of the recent examples, this idea of that anti-ISIS coalition is impossible without Russia. I can give you an example how it sneaked to the Western public opinion. So again, it was started by trolls. Then it was picked up by unknown websites within Russia. Then it went to the Russian primetime television. The next morning, it was picked up by blogs within European Union. Then it was picked up by mainstream media and politicians like Berlusconi and Sarkozy. And then in the evening, all major European media already been quoting all of them and saying, well, coalition is impossible without Russia. How do we know that? It just accepted already as a granted. It's kind of a commonplace already. It just 2 days passed. But this narrative was also unfortunately abducted by propaganda in the wake of Paris attacks, and they use the situation to the maximum of their benefit.
We have time for one short question and one short answer for that short question. And the lady over here in black and gray, and if you can present yourself also.
Thank you very
much. One, please.
Adit, okay. Olena Pristeka, Ukrainian think tank liaison office in Brussels. I have one question to both of the speakers. So first of all, thank you for presenting us. But can you give us your sharp, as you were in your introduction, your sharp advices how to counteract propaganda in different levels? First of all, on the level of society. Second, the level of our authorities and expert level, and so on and so on. Just very sharp, which we can then distribute and use in our work. Thank you so much.
So, brief question, what to do, how to counter, and I look forward to some short answers. Alexander, пожалуйста.
Well, I don't think it's actually a short question, per se. The first thing that comes to mind is you need to continue telling people the truth. Outside of Russia, you still have this possibility talking to the representatives of the civil society. In Russia, it's really difficult because 88% support President Putin. And when he says that Crimea belongs to us, well, you try to outline your reasoning, but then you understand that you speak at cross purposes. They don't hear each other because their level of propaganda is so high, there is no way to turn the tide. When it comes to people outside of Russia, you just need to continue delivering your narrative. Ask logical questions. Okay, well, if everything is so good in Russia as it's been portrayed, why people flee the country? If it's so good in Russia, why the officials place their children to study in Europe and in the US? These are logical questions. So if people have not lost their ability to think, then perhaps they would start looking for answers as well. And I think talking to people is of paramount importance. Support pluralism of opinions, because there are people who support Russia. Okay, let them be, but let them outline their views. When it comes to Russia, how to overcome propaganda there, I really don't know, because the system in Russia is such that it works just for the benefit of one person, i.e. Vladimir Putin. Whatever Putin wants, that's exactly what will happen. If he wants propaganda to take place no more, if he wants, that's what it will be like. But if he wants propaganda to be forever, that's also how it will be. And when it comes to Russia, if we actually start showing sheep that will be saying meh for 24/7 for 2 weeks, that's how everyone will start speaking in 2 weeks. So people need to hear and people need to speak.
Thank you, Alexander. Well, we believe that basically what you were saying, that it's important to lead a dialogue both internationally and domestically with your own people and abroad with foreigners.
One more short question.
Also not be very short, because there are different levels how you can react to that. There can be, for example, international level, and here I can praise the Stratcom efforts, and Jakub is over here. So this is quite important from even symbolical point of view, because this is the first time EU is answering this very challenge and gives very clear answer that European Union is not going to accept all this at a face value. This is very important, and I think Russia appreciated these efforts. The second level can be national level, because it's up to the every national government to care about its information security. Because basically, when we say that propaganda operates everywhere, it would be generalization, because propaganda operates within each specific country. For example, RT subsidiary Raptly is operating from Berlin, and in every almost every country of EU, you can find some subsidiaries of this propaganda machine. So probably it would be wise to rethink the licensing process and look into their practices and to evaluate if they are up to the standards of real journalism. And here I can quote the example of British Ofcom, who already gave its evaluation of what RT is doing and how they cover in different events. Probably it would be wise to look into the financing of this system, because I'm always quoting here the example of RT America director, who was in prison for 1 year for tax evasion. So probably here is the answer how propaganda machine is financed. Probably that's financed with cash, and if you would follow the cash, you might follow those people who are kind of behind that. And the next level would be professional level, how journalists themselves should answer to this. And here we come again to the ethical issues, because this should be evaluated by journalists themselves. Is they still continue to participate in this, if they are still consider themselves a journalist, and if people outside of this system should continue talking to these people as to the journalist. Because my point of view is that they are not media, but they are mistakenly still considered to be media. They should be just stripped of this whole notion that they belong to the media, because that corrupt the media and journalism in general. And then the very last level, but probably the most important, is the general audience. General audience should be explained what propaganda is, how it operates, and how they should critically consume everything they consume. So basically, this is the issue of media literacy for everyone. So that is my short answer to this.
Thank you, Jochen, for your short answer and your, so to speak, layer cake of answers to the question how to deal with propaganda. First of all, of course, thank you very much for mentioning the Stratcom Task Force, which I represent here in the room together with my colleague Jakub Kalinski, who is sitting over here, who is our chief editor of the weekly product we have, which is an open product that everyone can sign up for, a product called the Disinformation Review, which covers disinformation issues in a weekly output. If you're interested in signing up for that, do not hesitate to talk to my colleague Jakub Kalinski. You also mentioned the national level that is important, individual countries that are targeted by propaganda. You talked about professional level, talking to journalists, making them aware of the ethical challenges that they face, and then finally also what you could call educational level of media literacy, making the audience resilient, so to speak, to the impact of propaganda. Thank you very much to the two speakers today and to the two members of the European Parliament who opened this session before we move to the second half of the program today. I think we owe them an applause.
Thank you. Good job. Good job.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Without a break, we move now to the second half of today's program. There will be some changing of places here in the front of the room. Today, this second half of today's program will end with two colleagues of Michael and Petras, namely Mark Demesmaeker and Rebecca Harms, both also members of the European Parliament, who will close the second half of the program today. During this second half, we will have two speakers, Jessica Aro and Marike Aden, and I'm Aden, and I'm going to introduce them once the reseating here has taken place. So we, without losing time, we continue the program. First things first, again, let me remind the speakers of the fact that we are being live streamed and we are also being subject to simultaneous interpretation. Thank you to the interpreters in order to give them a chance to represent what we say and what is being said in a high quality way. We do need to be concise and not to speak too fast. Another technical aspect of today's gathering, unfortunately, the lamp that throws the images from the slides to this screen behind me over here is not working. So when you want to look at the slides that the speakers use, you will have to look in this direction where I'm pointing now, where there is another screen that should be used as a reserve screen. When unfortunately the main screen here is not working. So after having had a meeting now with two speakers who come from the east of the European Union, we now move into the European Union proper with two professionals, one coming from the member state of Finland, the second coming from the member state of Germany, also professionals in the field who can provide answers to the call for expert knowledge that I heard the honored members of the European Parliament voicing when we started today. The first speaker is Jessica Aro. Jessica is an investigative reporter on Finnish broadcasting company Yle, the national broadcaster, specializing in Russia, but also extremism, security, and social media. Her investigation, we are told here, on pro-Russia propaganda trolls resulted in her becoming a high-level target for systematic and long-term Kremlin-style harassment. And Jessica, we look forward to your presentation.
I would also like to present myself with the names the trolls and propagandists call me. So they don't see me as an investigative journalist. They call me and they tell the world that I am, for example, Nazi whore, CIA agent, NATO troll, CIA troll, liar, and Russophobe. So there. So, yeah, nice to meet you. I want to tell you about my investigations about the trolls and propagandists in the sites the Finnish people use, and then also my story, which started the same day I started to investigate this topic. So let's first take a look at a video, which I filmed at the troll factory in St. Petersburg. So we'll get to the video later. I will start telling you about other stuff. It needs subtitles and they weren't there. So about a year ago, or already a little over a year ago, I published. Okay, now we have the video. Subtitles on. Do you want to watch this? Come and see this. This is at the Troll Factory. We were trying to get interviews from the people who were working there, but they didn't want to give the interviews. So then we secretly kind of interviewed one of them. And this is the reason why the person's face is not showing. because we want he really didn't want to speak to us, but we still wanted to get information from this factory, which is so well secreted. So go on.
Я думаю, что я обладаю такими полномочиями отвечать какие-то вопросы.
Просто про вашу работу. Слушайте,
нет,
я журналист. Если у меня спросят про работу, я скажу, что...
Ну, вы журналист, а на другая работа. Вы журналист, я все время
говорю. А вы кто
просите? Ну, у меня все, я сам есть обязанности. Я все же не могу вам ничего сказать.
Ну, хотя бы скажите, если вы не журналист, то кто еще есть в агентстве новостей?
Есть журналисты, вот вы можете их подкараулить.
Ну, к сожалению, у вас журналист почему-то боится разговаривать. Вам запрещено говорить о своей работе?
Нет, почему? Ну, я просто не очень люблю перепоминать телекрану, когда я просто не люблю, когда не снимаю.
Мы же не снимаем, хотя бы...
Нет, ну все равно, я не люблю вообще разговаривать на какие-то такие откровенные темы.
Никаких откровенных тем, господи, просто про вашу работу.
Ну, я не очень хочу разговаривать о своей работе.
Хорошо, можете рассказать, о чем пишет ваша работа?
А таких, ну, я тоже, это разговор о работе.
А что содержание, ваш контент, это тоже государственная тайна?
Да, при чем здесь государственная тайна?
Ну, почему вы не хотите об этом
говорить? Ну, просто я не хочу об этом говорить. Вы можете, сейчас как раз смена начинается новая, вы сможете сейчас встретить кого-то, вы можете быть вашим.
К сожалению, почему-то никто не хочет рассказать о себе.
Ну, я, к сожалению, вы можете начать, вы можете дождаться. Он тоже подъедет скоро.
С вашей начальством вчера разговаривали тоже.
Я, к сожалению, не могу вам ничего сказать. Я, скажем так, сам ничего не знаю.
Почему у вас на здании нет одного познавательного знака? Что здесь за организация?
Ну, я не знаю, но это же не ко мне вопрос, эти вопросы, скорее всего, к начальству. Я обычный рядовой рабочий.
А внутри там есть какие-то обозначения организации?
Не знаю.
На выходные обычно бывает там?
Ну, там есть вход в здание через по карточкам, все.
А какого-то списка организаций, там, туда звоните так-то, туда звоните
так-то? Я не знаю. Не имею такой просто информации. Если бы знал, сказал бы.
Так как не имеете информацию? Он висит или нет в списке?
Я не знаю, я не видел.
Спасибо. Спасибо, извините.
Все доброго, до свидания.
Спасибо.
So there. You get the idea and the impression how these people who work in this factory are silenced. And later on we learned that all the people who work there have to sign like non-disclosure agreement for not to disclose anything. And that was the reason why, for example, him, of all the many people we tried to interview, didn't give out any answers to our questions. So then we did other kinds of research, but my research was about how the Russian propaganda, which is spread online in social media channels, how does it affect on Finnish people? Is there a lot of it going on? What is it like? How does it work? And what does it look like? This is also one of my findings. These texts were originally in Finnish, but because we also did stories in English, we translated everything, so you can see that the language is very similar. So these messages are like, I will read to you because you can't see them. The Western countries are fascist, and the leaders of Western countries are Nazis. Russia has not broken international law by annexing Crimea. Fascists invaded eastern Ukraine. There is no proof of the presence of Russia in eastern Ukraine. So these kinds of troll messages. Also about there was an unlawful fascist coup in Kiev and an unlawful military junta has the power now. So I will get back to that later. Now I will tell where it all started. This was my original article where I wanted people, Finnish people, to tell me about their experiences and information about online trolls. I was specific in the language in this story because I thought it might attract some attention, but I had no idea what kind of attention it would attract. Because almost immediately after I published the story, there is a very well-known World Without Nazism propagandist. He's self-proclaimed human rights activist, and he started to spread out the story to different online outlets, fake sites, troll sites, and all kinds of different kinds of sites that I work for. CIA, I'm famous assistant of like NATO, and I'm collecting an illegal register of Putin supporters in Finland, which of course was not true. And then this information was spread to maybe, I don't know, over 10 different pages, and then we can see what happened after that. And at the same time, there was attack against my employer too. So the troll activists, Johan Beckman's accomplices, like friends, they started to orchestrate this kind of complaints campaign to parliamentary ombudsman, and saying that while he is breaking like several different laws and defaming Finnish citizens who support Russia, and all the complaints were just like identical. And I saw it myself how it was orchestrated, and the critical, some people were critically asking that, is this really necessary? I don't see Wiley breaking any laws. So then the orchestrators would just kick them out of the conversations and continue waging hatred against Wiley and me. Then also there's one fake news site quite many, but one of them is called Verkkomedia, and by the way, of whose former chief editor now works in Donetsk and does Infowar there. He has Donny News Agency there, and that's an international fake news site. So this Finnish campaign was just a beginning for his like career. So that fake news site made, of course, big stories about how there are so many complaints about Wiley defaming campaign against Finnish citizens. All right, and then this is all from my email after disinformation was spread about me. It's really pity you can't see this, because it's just a similar kind. I can read some of this. For example, this is in English and in Russian, mostly in Russian, and it seems that it's translated into English with Google Translator. Fuck the EU, fuck the USA, Crimea, ours soon, and Donbass. Your government is fascist because it is American puppet state and approves Ukrainian Nazi. God punish you if you will continue persuasion of sincere people for their things. God with us, not your. Devil with your well-birded... A bearded pervert wins on Eurovision. So this stuff was just flooding on my email, and at the same time I got similar kinds of phone calls, similar kinds of text messages, and also some troll activists, they put up this Facebook like hate group against me and my project, and then later on also some other people who are criticizing Russia, and it's still on and ongoing, and they're just like writing really bad stuff about people, trying to get people to get tired and stop writing about Russia. This is also one picture I got to my email. There's a picture of Finnish flag which is smeared with Nazi symbols, and it says in Russian, Finsky fascism. And what struck me the most in this case was that there is already material like this. And it's just like ready for use, just like this. I got maybe 3 or 5 similar kinds of emails after Johan Beckman spread his propaganda about me. And the message was just clear that we have this material and we're ready to use it. All right. And this is then screen captures of some troll groups conversations, because of course the troll groups, when they're organized in Facebook, they also gather just like not troll Finnish people, just like ordinary citizens, and some of them then take influence. That's their point. And this is all about me. They're just like saying that they want to have like a nuclear attack to our office, and because we do so crap journalism, and that they hate me, and that I'm Russophobe, and she needs to, like, I need to go to mental institution, and that I'm a NATO troll, and it's just like this all the time. And also they're wondering that can I somehow like be happy about when I see some burning corpses of Odessa. And you know, even the trolling about like general political subjects, like Russia's policies abroad, the trolling messages are similar kind. They are just like really aggressive, really not true, and just like crazy. But some of them, of course, is more intelligent, but it's the, like, this is the quality. It doesn't matter if it's about some journalist or some researcher or some private person commenting on Russia's issues publicly. This is the quality, so it's really crap quality sometimes. And here is some of my findings. So I made a list, not of Putin's supporters in Finland, but I made a list of the different kinds of online platforms in which there are aggressive pro-Russia anonymous online influencers, and which have influence also in Finnish people. So some or many pages that Finnish people use. There are just like so many different kinds of pages, some of them abroad, some of them in Finland, of course all the social media platforms. And I really thoroughly searched because I got so many also good messages telling me tips about where to find trolling. So I spent a lot of time going through a lot of messages, and I filtered them, and I checked that they like fill the criteria. So there are about maybe 30 different pages. And on some of the pages, of course, the international ones, it's most aggressive, but also because we have so many sources of trolling also in Finland, many Finnish sites are also trolled just like every day, 24/7, just all the time. And then about what the trolls, the pro-Russia propagandists have accomplished. They have accomplished, in my findings, that there are Finns who have been silenced and who have been scared to not speak out their opinion about Russia's issues because they have encountered really hideous attacks, for example, on Twitter. And by the way, Yevhen, about this Twitter trolling, we also have one source of trolling in Finland, which is the Russian embassy of Finland. They do really interesting like Twitter campaigns, and they also block critical journalists, and they like tweet really just like pure like West is kind of Nazi propaganda, and pictures of dead corpses also some while ago. At some point they cleaned it up a little bit, but it's still ongoing. So then other findings I had was that many Finns were also confused because they were fed with lies, and they were linked with pictures that were fake, and they were linked with graphics that were fake, and they told me that they had mixed up what's true and what's not true. So, but this is my personal opinion. I think the most sad influence is that some Finns were themselves turned into propagandists. So some Finns turned into like really like trollers themselves after hanging out some time with the anonymous trolls. So you can really say in my investigation that Finnish public day pass, a public debate has been manipulated, and Finnish freedom of speech, which is by the way number one in the world, unlike in Russia, it has been influenced. But they also, the trolls and propagandists, have had many defeats. And at this time, I would say, as my opinion, that the defeats are for them bigger than the victories. So many Finns are not influenced in any way. People also told me in my crowdsourcing that they have no effect. They know how this works. They don't care. Then also one troll defeat, but victory for freedom of speech, is that now the Russia's info tactics are really well uncovered, because the troll phenomenon is now really widely made public, at least in Finland, and has been already for some time. And also good news is that now Finns recognize and counter Russian propaganda better than ever. So there. But yeah, I agree with some the previous speakers that it will just get worse from here. This is just a start. So we need...
Thank you to Jesse. Thank you to Jessica Aro for sharing your expert knowledge with us, the fruits of your investigative journalism, but also for sharing your disturbing testimony of having been targeted yourself personally in this trolling that you have been working with. I also want to thank you for addressing the issue that is in the title of today's meeting, Trolls of the 21st Century, Kremlin Inside the Western Media. Now we are moving from the battlegrounds of Ukraine and Russia into the member states in the European Union. Thank you. There is some time for a couple of questions, so please raise your hand, and when you ask your question, please do introduce yourself. Yes, I forgot that was the order we did it last time. Yes, so that was the way we did it.
I mean, we can do it the other way around. No, is that fine?
I think we should be conservative, and thank you for reminding me, and stick to the system we used before the middle of the program. So yes, I now hand over the word
to Malaike.
I hand over the word to Malaike.
Sorry. I'm stealing that from you. I'm sorry.
Sorry, Malaike. Aden is a colleague of Jessica in the sense that Malaike also worked for a public broadcaster. This time we are moving south to Germany. Malaike is a journalist who has been covering Russian affairs for quite a while, including a long-term stay in Russia as a correspondent. She worked for a series of German outputs besides the German national or the public broadcasters, and she now also deals with other issues, I've been told, but still remains devoted to the study of what happens in Russia. Malaike, the floor is yours.
Thanks so much. That's what happens to you. You're very conservative and cling to stability after you lived in 7 years of Russia, I guess. So yeah, as you can read in my biography, I spent 7 years in Russia, mainly as a freelance correspondent for Deutsche Welle, Germany's international broadcaster. And one of the main things I really learned while living in Russia, and obviously watching, due to my profession, lots of Russian state TV, is that propaganda really works well, and it works much better than I ever had expected. I mean, I was born in 83, so Cold War rhetoric is something I only know from textbooks and from my studies of journalism. What we hear from Germany from the Nazi times, how Goebbels reorganized and built up all this propaganda, that's also something I was very aware of. But seeing propaganda work out in reality, how it shapes people surrounding you and how it actually also influences yourself is something that was really fascinating and frightening at the same time. So for my university thesis, actually, I analyzed Russian state media in 2008 very closely. So I had to watch that every day, every hour back then. And so I actually really saw also how state TV in Russia changed. Obviously, in 2008, that was when Vladimir Putin was just becoming prime minister and stepping away from the presidency for a while. It was also very crafted already, but it wasn't as aggressive as it became in 2012 after the mass protests in Russia. State TV became more about this is us and that's the enemy surrounding us. It became more hysterical, it became more emotional, and it again gained pace in the end of 2013 and 2014 with the Ukrainian crisis. unfolding. And yeah, so I would like to briefly talk about some aspects that I found interesting, and then maybe we can have a discussion afterwards. What Alexandra said before, that she cannot really understand why many Russians rather focus on problems in the US than when they sit, even when they sit in the kitchen without electricity, or when they have to go to the toilet in the garden. I think that's also due to the fact that these news that they get every evening are just so fast and so hysteric, and it's much faster than we cut it. And I always feel that, even I, that I feel like, oh wow, after watching these news, I'm really glad I'm in Russia, you know, like my kitchen here feels safe. I think the world is a very threatening place in Russian state TV. So first thing that I understood is that Kremlin-controlled TV is really about emotions, about conspiracy theories these days, and about this feeling they against us. So if we briefly touch on the example of Maidan again, I think if I hadn't been there so many weeks, I would believe myself that there were so many Nazis. And I've been asked a lot of times by politicians, by political scientists in Germany, in the US, tell me how many Nazis were there really? So I think that the Kremlin in that way really succeeded in shaping the narrative, that's the first question that we ask ourselves these days. It's with Crimea, I also really saw how propaganda is influencing us. I headed to Simferopol at the beginning of March, so that was a couple of days after the Ukrainian, the regional parliament of Crimea had been taken over. And obviously we watch state TV at work, so, you know, because it's the pulse of what's going on. So we heard all this news about the genocide that was going to take place towards the Russian people. We heard about endless memorials for the Second World War that had been smeared with graffiti. So I had this sense, okay, so maybe let's reduce all this by 99%, but maybe 1% probably is true, because that's what Russian state TV does, right? It exaggerates and it twists. But when I came to Simferopol, I really saw, okay, so the real threat probably is for those people who speak Russian with an accent, or English. So that's actually, for me, it was a turning point when I didn't feel that they are only twisting and turning and exaggerating, but they're actually making up stuff. And that's afterwards when the story with the crucified boy and all that happened. For me, the moment when I saw, okay, now they're lying, that was really the Ukrainian crisis. I think the MH17, all that discussion, is a really good example how the attention was distracted from the separatists and the Russian influence on them by just bombarding us with other versions, by saying, okay, so maybe actually they meant to down Putin's plane because it looked similar and it was on the way back. Then there was this absurd theory about that it was actually the plane that had disappeared earlier from Malaysian Airlines, if I'm not mistaken. And then the more standard almost explanation that was said, well, it was actually Ukraine downing it. And for Ukraine, it was very, for Russia, excuse me, it was very successful. I think now 80% believe, right, that actually Ukraine shot the plane down. So I think that's a very good example for how the narrative, again, was shaped, and how these explanations are also making world headlines, because that's obviously what we do. We also present as journalists the Russian point of view. And that's, as it was mentioned earlier, the weakness that is exploited there. So it's all about confusion, as Yevgen said before. Then just briefly, I want to mention Russia Today Deutschland. I think they call it RT Deutschland. And they are actually, I think they started a year ago. They do look very amateurish in comparison to what we know from the British version of Russia Today. They have presenters who I think haven't worked in TV before, and they have a show that's called The Missing Part. So that's what they actually want to do. They say, well, you know, all the standard, the mainstream media, they blend out the most important thing and we give you the whole truth. They don't have a lot of people who watch their show, I think, when it's on the YouTube channel, but they have lots of followers anyway, and that's the same with the Sputnik news agency. They also, I think they're on social media, they're advancing fast, and faster than they are in standard media. I think they're with Sputnik Radio, which is also part of this Россия сегодня, media institution now that is built. I think they are rebroadcasting in Germany their radio program on two channels or in two regions of Germany. So it's not very significant yet, but I think that will be on the rise. And what is something about Russia today that I always remember a lot is when they wanted to get kind of famous, established themselves as a brand also with us Moscow correspondents. They, I think it was 2009 or 10, they started a service that was called Free Video. So all journalists could just log in and download material that was shot by Russia Today. Obviously with them having crews all over the place, it was very convenient. So you could not only get Putin's statement, but also some experts that they had, of course, carefully crafted. And you could not only get the raw video material for your stories, you can also could also download, I'm not sure if you can do that still because they stopped it at some stage, but for years, you could download this ready-to-broadcast stories and you could use them for free. They were sometimes about cultural stuff, you know, about the Buranovsky Babushki, those like sweet grandmas, you know, that were at the Eurovision Song Contest. But then you had economy stories, or you would have a story about the Baltics. And then, you know, just one sentence, maybe just slipping in a very Russian point of view there. So I think especially for media who are not very well financed, that was probably very attractive to broadcast these stories. And so I think that's something that is a gateway to the propaganda when we speak to the Western, about the Western media. Just very briefly, I think we also have to ask ourselves, even if I don't want to do any victim blaming here, but I think we also have to ask ourselves why these alternative theories, how the Russians call it, are in a way successful in some countries. Why are they successful in Germany? Some Germans are susceptible to that. We see that a lot with our German broadcasters. In online media, we get lots of comments. There are also lots of formal complaints now. They might be coordinated, but I don't believe that all of those are Kremlin trolls. I think that a lot of people actually are just so fed up with the establishment, with politicians, with journalists. They don't believe us anymore, which I also find very frustrating when under my stories, their comments, so hey, did you really accompany those people to Donbass? You paid them, right? Didn't you? And I actually seriously get asked those questions, and I don't think that that's Kremlin people asking me or Kremlin paid people. That's really people not trusting us anymore. So that's, a problem we have to deal with, a challenge. And in Germany especially, it's the growing anti-Americanism, I find, that plays a huge role. I returned to Germany a year ago, and that's something that I'm still trying to understand how that came about. I guess it's due to the NSA scandal, the Iraq, the Afghanistan wars. But to many Germans, it's appealing to look at the Kremlin-controlled media and find it as a way to look at the world in a more multipolar way. And they see that Putin stands up to Obama. Wow, that's great. And the last point I think that would be interesting to discuss here is also what should we do about it? I mean, what should journalists do about it? Obviously, I can more speak about the journalist point of view. And what should politicians do about it? I know what we shouldn't do about it, and that's censor ourselves, like unfortunately some colleagues in Ukraine, for example, do now. I had the very unfortunate experience that one of my reports about Ukrainian right-wing activists who were indeed very right-wing with the right sector in summer, and we made a TV report about that in first German media. And then 3 days later, I found a large extracts from my report with my voice on Russian state TV primetime. Of course, I wasn't asked. I just saw that actually accidentally, and it wasn't. And I think the text by the presenter was, well, finally, German media have realized that all Ukrainians were Nazis in the first place. Of course, that was a very unpleasant experience. And I had one evening of freaking out about it, actually, and got into some arguments with Ukrainian colleagues who were saying, how could you do that? You know, you're a traitor. And I was like, well, why could I do that? I did show those swastikas because they were there, you know? So I wouldn't want to even, it's a bad experience when you play into the hand of Russian propaganda, but that's the way it works. It exploits that we want to show more. And I wouldn't want to censor myself. I think that journalists shouldn't do that, because then we are even more lose the trust of the people in Germany or in any other country. And I was actually working with Deutsche Welle for so many years. Now I'm working with another public channel, although it's kind of state-funded also, because its budget is government-approved, parliament-approved. I was very glad that in Germany, Deutsche Welle is not seen as, or their channel is not seen as a means to influence or to make propaganda. So I wouldn't hope that that's the way it will go for Europe. But I think, yeah, we are stuck between a rock and a hard place there. So, sorry for the bleak outlook.
Thank you, Marika.
Thank you for important comments. Also, for your testimony of having worked underground, both in Russia and Ukraine, I can't help noting that you told us that Ukraine was not the only place where we saw an escalation in Russian media. It already happened earlier during the late 2011 and early 2012 double elections in Russia, where there were some standoffs between opposition and Kremlin in Moscow that led to a escalation in the Russian media scene. Two, and then of course you reinvoke something that has been said several times here, that the aim of propaganda is to distract us. It is to, you mentioned the MH17 disaster and how that was literally stories were thrown in to distract from what many accepted as the main and most trustworthy explanation, that it was such a shutdown by separatists in eastern Ukraine. You also addressed the issue of media literacy and what should be done, certainly a question. And then you called for a question to politicians. You asked politicians to think about what should be done as a political level. And that, of course, something I hope that the two honored members of the European Parliament, who's going to be commenting after the question and answer session here, that they will remember that question, what should be done from the point of view of politicians. But now the floor is open to questions to Jessica and Marijke. And when you ask a question, please do introduce yourself. There's a lady over here.
Thank you very much for the other comments. It's not only the journalists that are targeted. Myself, I'm coming here in the European Parliament, and I have a very critical position concerning the Putin government. And I was targeted by Russian origin from the Baltic country. She is working here for a time in the European Parliament. She targeted me. She spoke me here in the European Parliament, and she say to me, I must give up my German nationality. German, they are Nazis, and I am a Nazi. And also a Nazi is an European functionary, German nationality. And she's doing this all via the email. If I don't agree with this, that Russia is a good government and Putin is a good one, I say, I don't agree with you. It's my opinion. I'm speaking free here. Every time that I'm coming here to another conference, she is coming behind me, then I must call the security services of the parliament, and now she is stopping. I complain to the European Ombudsman, to the Secretary General of Parliament, because I speak with the Belgian policy say, look, she gives no mobile phone, she don't give me the address where she is living, they can do nothing, they are European institution. Okay. So the people are targeted also in the European institution.
Madam, thank you for your testimony, and thank you for sharing your story with us. We very much appreciate that. Does anyone want to comment on that testimony? Thank you for that. If not, then further questions from the... Yes, the gentleman over here.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. My name is Kirill Ivanov. I'm third secretary of the permanent mission of Russia to the European Union. And I'd like to make a few comments. Firstly, many of speakers, audience admitted to remind us about strong Russian concerns over the trumped up specter of Russian propaganda which is used by many EU member states to flaunt their international commitments regarding freedom of speech, freedom of media, and free flow of expression, and free flow of information. Also, when it comes to the concept of trolling, we have strong impression that these largely depends on your political point of view. Following the logic of many speakers, it is now considered normal to dub people who you are not, you do not agree with, trolls, and information that you do not accept due to political reasons as disinformation and propaganda. Let me give you a short example. In Russian MFA social media accounts, we encounter on regular basis comments by a number of anti-Russian groups and individuals, sometimes hate speech, Russophobe statements. The question is, following your logic, does it mean that we should consider them to be trolls? And the very last thing, it is very regrettable that so many young media professionals and experienced media professionals here at the heart of Europe are, instead of concentrating on thinking together how to counter radicalization of terrorists, foreign fighters, through social media and elsewhere, you are concentrating on fighting mythical Russian threat. Thank you.
Thank you. A very important question. A very important. I will have to let the panel answer first. A very important question from a Russian colleague. Welcome. If we look inwards, is the problem that we are facing and talking about today a problem that can also be identified in the inside the European Union? Maybe some comments on that. I think that's an important question to answer. Yes, Jessica, if you will start.
Yes, I'd like to comment. Thank you for your comments and feedback. I also have a question for you. The question is that I would really love to hear your view about the troll factories in St. Petersburg and in Russia, and also like Russia's diplomatic missions trolling activities in social media, because I, for example, tried to get answer from Russian embassy in Helsinki that why do you do this, but they did not answer my various questions, not once. So maybe you can answer, please.
Short answer
from
the
Russian colleague. I'm not a panelist. If you'd like, we can continue. I'm open to discussing that.
Let's continue later. Great.
Absolutely. Good. We can exchange contacts, business cards.
Very good. Of course, there is, as you as pointed out, the opportunity to continue discussion that I started in the room here after. There was a gentleman with a question over here, the gentleman raising his hand.
So my name is Viktor Kolomiec. I am from Ukrainian television. I will speak in Russian, because I think that my colleague from the embassy and Russia in general thinks that all the people who speaks Russian are pursued in Ukraine. That's why I will speak Russian, because I know Russian, English, and Ukrainian as well, and I'm proud of it.
So, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to comment what the gentleman said. I work in the Ukrainian TV for many years, and I follow everything what's happening in the Russian TV and media for a long, long time. I've never come across such blatant nonsense, lies, and misinformation in all my life, even though I'm fairly young. Please do not confuse things that I've just named what you are trying to block our ears with. Lies, propaganda, is not an opposite view, is not an alternative vision. It is a part of the state-run policy. It is the policy of the Kremlin. And in this connection, I would like to ask you the following question, since I'm giving this opportunity. While we were working here last year, this year, we were talking with you personally over the phone and so on. All the diplomatic staff, all the highest officials, all the representatives of Russia refuse to be interviewed by our channel, 112 Ukraine. Mr. Pushkov, for example, who was in this building last week, even tried to, you know, make himself up before the interview. But as soon as he heard that it is the Ukrainian television that's going to interview him, he just ran away. He literally ran away. And we were chasing Mr. Pushkov, asking for his view, his opinion. Please, talk to us. We're not going to twist or misrepresent your intervention. We're going to present your view as it is. Indeed, not everything is perfect in Ukraine, and indeed there are nationalistic and fascism on the rise in Ukraine, but there is more of that stuff in Russia rather than in Ukraine. And please do not lie. Please do not provide misinformation. And this is everything I wanted to say.
My Russian colleague to decide if he wants to answer, because there were questions addressed to you, or do you also want to keep those in the corridor after the meeting?
Colleagues, I said what
brief
I
answer,
said.
Brief answer, please. Yes.
For all those who would like to follow comments, interviews by Russian officials, I strongly recommend to follow numerous Twitter, Facebook and other accounts of Russian MFA and Russian embassies. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your answer.
I'm open to your questions afterwards.
Thank you, sir. We have a question from a lady over here in blue.
My name is Anna Javorska. You know, one way to stop radicalization is that Russia stops funding those parties. You know, I wish I could laugh at trolls here and their examples that were shown here. But unfortunately, disinformation kills people, thousands of people. And I'm afraid Europe is not immune to this. And I want to ask you the question, who has to be monitoring this? Who has to be this media police? Who do we have to filter out those fake websites, etc.? How do we ensure the balance between freedom of speech and its violations, and those who violate it to make sure that they are punished? Thank you.
What do you mean by being banished? Where from? From social media or?
Yes, for example, we talk about Russia today and other things, and we know that Russia is putting, for example, some info bullets in Le Soir, other ways, you know, there are other ways that they spread their disinformation from. So how can we stop it? Can we stop it?
Yeah, that's exactly also what I keep on asking myself, and I don't really have come up with an answer that. But I'm of the strong opinion that counter-propaganda is not the answer. I'm very skeptical towards the new idea that has come up in the US and also in the European Union, that there has to be a more proactive approach to that, maybe even a kind of, I think I heard that in the US recently at think tanks, there needs to be anti-propaganda. We are so good at hybrid warfare, we have to go in there again with information war. I feel very uncomfortable, I don't know, as a journalist with participating in that. And I also think that that's exactly when it's even easier for us like for people to criticize us. It's even easier for Russian state officials to say, well, look at the biased Western media, look how they are just doing propaganda, and they accuse us of it, and they're having the double standards, as double standards is the word of the hour, of the decade, it seems, in Russian state TV and in the discussion. So I wish I could give you an answer of what to do, but I feel that banning and saying, well, let's just try to be better at the propaganda than the Kremlin, I don't feel that's the solution. I would be very interested in hearing also the view of politicians in that matter. I'm kind of really at a loss there, and I think that banning them and revoking licenses is not the way.
Very interesting discussion that I certainly hope the honored members of the parliament who are present here today will also address. Do you want to answer that question? Do we have a comment?
Just really quickly that to your question, can it be stopped? No. So what can be done? Educate people. That's the key, really. Educate people first. Educate journalists, educate anyone who comes to terms with or who counters propaganda. So everyone.
Yes, one more comment over here to that, what was just said.
Yeah, just very quickly, I find that especially in this propaganda war that we are in, speaking Russian really helps. So I think the more people will actually learn Russian, that will be a good thing, because that's actually what also editors sometimes, they go like, okay, so can we really do, so where's the source? And it's like, yeah, well, this is the source, you know? So like, there's no source for it. Like, it's just state TV saying this. So I would actually love it if more Germans would return or would approach that. I'm mainly, like, people ask me, oh my God, why do you know Russian? So I think actually maybe that's the thing also, because that helps to be informed, to actually kind of be able to distinguish.
And definitely in this room, there's been a lot of Russian spoken already, which is a testimony of these sort of inclusive approach that you are talking in favor of. One last question for last answers over here, gentlemen.
Maybe you know that there will be a referendum on the Ukrainian on the association treaty between Ukraine and the EU and the Netherlands in April 2016. There has been a website which is more or less populist right-wing, Geen Stijl, for the people who know it, who tried to initiate this referendum, and they were successful with more than 400,000 people to sign for that referendum. And it has been claimed, and that's why I'm here, it has been claimed by the proponents of the association treaty that the people from the weblog who are against the treaty were actually just influenced by Russian propaganda. And what I'm wondering is, from the Dutch perspective, I do not know how I can check that claim. So what I'm actually, because actually the Russian diplomat, I tend to agree with him. I do tend to agree that if you say, okay, there is the Russian point of view and you have the European point of view, the European point of view is in favor of the association treaty and the Russians are against. So if you're against, that's probably Russian propaganda. But actually for me, it's still a black box. So I'm wondering whether someone could say a little bit more about how can we discover whether Russian propaganda whether the Russian propaganda caused this referendum to happen in April. Thank you.
I have to say I'm not familiar with how the referendum came about. I find it very interesting to hear about that. I do agree with you in a way, and also with the Russian diplomat over there, that it's too easy to say it's just trolls. I think it has become kind of a reflex in the discussion for some very fervent activists, which I can understand in a way as well, because obviously it's horrible to see, also when you're a reporter, what's happening with your country. Specifically here, when I talk about Ukraine, then maybe you sometimes, you know, react in a way that you say, well, it's all just trolling. No, of course, it's not all trolling. There are serious concerns that have to be addressed. It can't be just all, oh, they're trolls, they're fascists, and so on, because that's actually when we give in to this kind of black and white and emotional kind of thing. But it is true, there is a narrative now that has been kind of established to, well, there was a coup and we have to deal with that. I think it's reading as much as possible, kind of. It's again, it's being at a loss. It's such a horrible place where this whole Ukrainian crisis has gone. I think it's even it's hard to talk, as Alexandra said before. And I don't know a lot actually about the situation in the Netherlands, and it would be interesting to know from you how strong the.
But the point, of course, is the Dutch journalists don't know either. So the only thing we get the whole time is the claim that when you're against the association treaty, that's Russian propaganda. And I'm wondering whether someone can give us any proof on that. And I mean, actually, I'm one to do the research myself, but I mean, give me some kind of a clue on where to find it.
Okay, so a call for, and I think it's more than a question, it's a call for the media professionals in the room to address the issue of proof. One thing is to talk about propaganda, another thing is to prove its presence and prove the sort of machinery that is perhaps behind the shaping of opinion that we are addressing now. Do you have a last brief comment to that, or can we move to...
I rely my work on proof and showing what's happening, and I strongly suggest to others too. Yeah, because we as journalists also, we lose trust if we provide any kind of wrong information. So that's why proper investigations need to be done, and proper journalism, and not just really fast, quick, not really thoughtful journalism.
Okay, thank you. Now we move to the last part of the program. We have framed today's program with interventions by members of the European Parliament. When we started this morning at 9, we had Petras Auštrevičius and Mikhail Boni speaking, giving some important opening remarks that I have heard echoed in many of the interventions today. We also end the program with two honored members of the Parliament, Mark Demesmaeker and Rebecca Harms. And Mark, will you start?
Yeah, okay, for me. Ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, I think this conference was extremely useful, and that we have learned a lot. The things that I will remember is that the production of fake information, of false information in Russia has almost become an industry. An entire system of commentators, pro-government commentators, companies, as we saw with people on their payroll, that work in shifts and spend days in their offices writing pro-Kremlin comments on the internet. It's like a growth industry in an economy that is sliding towards recession. There have been revelations today by the people from first hand, and there had been some revelations before in the press, like that of Ludmila Savchuk, who is a local activist in St. Petersburg, who took a job at the troll factory, worked there for a couple of months to expose this trolling operation, and who sued the company. Very successfully, even. And she is one of those brave people, I think, who forced it out of the shadow, and that is what has to happen, out of the shadow and even into court. But despite of these revelations that we have seen, and I think this conference was very useful in that regard as well, it has failed up till now to spark any major, you know, public outrage or public scandal. So we have still some work to do. Society still is kind of apathetic towards this phenomenon. But we have to realize that the Kremlin has deliberately waged this massive disinformation campaign for certain aims, to justify the annexation of Crimea or the hybrid war in eastern Ukraine, and thereby invading not the hardware territory but the online territories with their troll armies, armed with pro-Moscow rhetoric. I think that we are on the way forward. East Stratcom has started its operation since September.
Since the spring, but in fully staffed.
Since September. I think they're doing an outstanding job in giving us, on a regular basis, updates and analysis. But still, I think it's a battle of David against Goliath. But then we know who won the battle, after all. It's important also, and this is something I heard today as well, it's important to keep up with the Kremlin and their narratives. We see there a shift after the Paris attacks. The main subject of disinformation has now changed. And I have read the latest update, I think it arrived yesterday in my mailbox of Stratcom, with all the stories that are going on now. So the conspiracy theories have been shifted now towards Turkey, the role of Turkey, supporting ISIS. A similar pattern regarding another ISIS ally, so-called ISIS ally, Ukraine, indeed. And I see there a very... and I see this kind of information, that worries me a lot. I see that kind of information popping up in our media, popping up on our social networks like Facebook, like Twitter. So it has found its way again into our own, in the heart of our own society, and that worries me because this time it's different. You know, people were not directly engaged in what was going on in Ukraine. They are engaged in what is going on now. We are being confronted with a migration crisis. The war against ISIS, we are directly involved. The war against terrorism, we've had the terror alerts here in Brussels and the attacks in Paris, which is not so far, so people are afraid. And whoever is fighting ISIS is and bombing ISIS is a hero, is a friend and an ally. So, when they are targeting, when Russia is targeting ISIS, and when they are doing the right thing there, in the eyes of the people, so why should they be wrong also targeting Ukrainians and blaming the Ukrainians? See, it is a very dangerous evolution going on in the minds of our people now. How to tackle this? Well, before I had a real job, you know. Until 12 years ago, I had a real job. I was a journalist. I was a professional TV journalist here in Belgium, in Flanders. So I know that freedom of speech, freedom of media is very important. It's one of our key values. It's our immune system of our Western way of life and of our democracies. And I think, indeed, and I agree with my ex-colleague, that counter-propaganda, it will not work. We have to answer with outstanding journalism, with good journalism, with independent journalism. We have to reveal, we have to expose, we have to show our public that there is something like this trolling going on, like this fake information and disinformation going on. The answer is with good, independent, professional journalism. We have to promote that. We have to sponsor that if necessary. We need journalists who have credibility. We have to establish this credibility again, and they have to bring underpinned information. And people will recognize this as authentic information. And they will make the difference, I think. They will make the difference at the end. Why do I say that? Because we have the Finnish, we have seen the Finnish there, the Finnish example, and it was very interesting to see that you can defeat the trolls, to uncover the tactics, to make and Finns recognize, and not all of them, but a lot of Finns recognize it now, encounter the Russian propaganda themselves. So. by making the machinery public. Yes, I will stop. I know I'm too long. I think we all bear a responsibility. Stratcom has its responsibility. They have to work good, hard, even harder. We have our responsibility as politicians. Our leaders have their responsibilities. We need good journalists, but we need brave politicians as well to stand up and tell the truth. And we need a good civil society. And one role, I think specific role, and I see representatives here of Promote Ukraine, which is an organization of expatriates, Ukrainian expatriates here in Flanders, in Belgium. I saw the representative of the Ukrainian World Congress with a network in 40 countries. I think indeed they are Russian speakers and they speak the local language and they have an important role to interact with our communities and with the communities back home in Ukraine and Russia. Thank you.
Thank you. And we will be running a little bit over time, but I think the importance of the subject does justify it. Last but not least, also member of the European Parliament, Rebecca Harms.
So I can't speak Russian, not yet. I just started my language courses, so we will see in 6 months. I might be able to threaten Russian trolls better than I can do it now. But that's only my introduction because I need a translation for those who don't follow the discussion in English. I think it's a bit more difficult, the situation, than to end with an appeal to us doing our jobs only better. I think, especially since Mr. Fedchenko has told us the story on Russian role in the Syrian alliances and how it was made, prepared in also the troll factories, is quite a signal for alert. I have so far no real answer to this, but my impression of the situation in which we stand is that the Kremlin, and I really underline also it's the Kremlin, it's not Russia or the Russians, but the Kremlin has some successes, so that in many EU member states, people really believe that the main fear in Russia is fascism in Ukraine, and therefore many of the actions might be justified. This is, for me, a reason to have really fear from the successes of the Kremlin propaganda, because it's crystal clear in the same time, and it's even not covered by the Kremlin, that the Kremlin is financing Marine Le Pen, that the Kremlin invites all extreme right parties, fascist parties, for meetings in Crimea so that they can come to a new Yalta resolution is only some months ago. And that these two worlds, so the anti-fascist propaganda by Russia against Ukraine, yeah, so that this is not connected in the European discussion with the actions of the Kremlin, with extreme right-wing parties in Europe. This is really a signal for high alerts. So how comes that Russia is so good to exploit our pluralism? I think so is because in the European countries, especially in the Western European countries, the knowledge about not only Ukraine, but also the knowledge about Russia and what it is today and how it became what it is today, the knowledge about this is very poor. And beyond all appeals of Mark, I would say that real informations about what Russia is and about what Ukraine is today and what the conflict is about is really still something which we need for the Europeans to be able to withstand these awful propaganda activities organized in the Kremlin. And then I have two additional ideas, and this also very much linked politically with what Mark said, but it opens another issue. So Ukraine as a target of propaganda is still weak in the development of good journalism and free and independent media. And so I really understand that times of war is probably not the best momentum to develop free and well-functioning independent media. But the real answer in Ukraine against the Russian propaganda should be journalism, should be information, and everybody responsible in Russia should think about the words used in this whole context, because sometimes the Ukrainians make it very easy that Russia can use what's going on in Ukraine. And for Europe, so Stratcom is so a response. It came late, it's a good try, but also for Europe, it's very necessary to think about journalism, how to strengthen journalism, how to strengthen pluralism, and to discuss with journalists how they deal with news made in Russia. Because this is, for me, really a very, very important question. So Russia is a non-democratic state. Russia is not a dictatorship, has not developed a dictatorship, so at least not in a classic way, but it's an authoritarian state with a non-functioning electoral system, for example, from our point of view. There are only few free media. Journalism never ever really had good times in Russia. Many journalists I could meet in Russia over the years, they have been killed. So how to deal in EU media with informations fabricated in the media in Russia? I think it's one of the crucial questions, because the way European media pick up so-called news or informations from Russia, this way very often is helping the troll factories in St. Petersburg. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you to all the members of the European Parliament for some strong political messages also from across from the platforms present in our Parliament. Thank you to the speakers who came from far away, some closer than others. We very much appreciate that. Thank you to the interpreters for interpretation between English and Russian and back. And first of all, of course, thank you to all those of you who attended this seminar.